Welcome to World Insight on CGTN. I'm Tian Wei in Beijing. This week, the country will hold one of its biggest political gatherings in Beijing, the annual two sessions. An array of issues are on the agenda, including China-U.S. relations in the post-COVID-19 world, and how can the two countries cooperate. To discuss all of these topics, I talk to Professor Jia Qingguo, member of the Standing Committee of CPPCC, professor from Peking University. Let's listen to his insights. I want to ask you about the phrase you recently wrote about, responsible power, and you argue that China has been one since the start of the epidemic. Tell me more as to why you say so.
China has to do its own things well. And then it tries to help others in order to live up to its own international responsibilities. So within a few months, China managed to contain the virus. The total number of infection people and also deaths are low by comparison to other countries. China began to help others, and China delivered many tons of medical supplies to other countries, especially to the developing countries. China also sent a lot of medical teams to other countries to help and also to share China's experience in managing the COVID-19 crisis. So in general, I think China has tried to be a responsible power, especially in its effort to contain the COVID-19 crisis and also in helping others to the COVID-19 virus.
Professor Jia, what do you make of the 5 points provided and announced by the Chinese President Xi Jinping during the just concluded World Health Assembly? Talking about a vaccine, talk about $2 billion aid to developing countries, talking about helping African hospitals, and talking about the future of cooperating with international communities. Some have been, you know, talking about it as if it was China's smart campaign, diplomatic campaign. How do you look at that?
President Xi's speech at the conference also show that despite all kinds of speculations, suspicions on the part of some people in the world, China will do what it believes to be the right thing to do. That is to do a good job in at home and also to help others at the same time. It's easy to question others' motivations, but what's most important is what others' actions. China will use its own actions to show to the world that it's responsible, it's sincere, and wants to help.
Professor Jia, we have seen a quote-unquote smear campaign. You also mentioned that recently in an article you wrote about the recent interactions between China and the West, particularly China and the United States. Some have been trying to talk little of whatever China is trying to do to help others and to assist the WHO. What do you make of the nature of these kinds of smear campaign? Should China care about it? Should the rest of the world care about what those people have always been saying and saying it all the time without really doing anything?
Well, every country has some people who always look at the other countries in a suspicious and maybe from a very negative perspective. It's natural. The virus, the crisis, has caused a lot of sufferings and deaths in those countries, and they are frustrated. They're angry, and some of them are desperate. So they're in an emotional mode. They want to criticize someone. That's one reason. Another reason is some governments, especially the Western government, have not been doing a good job in terms of containing the virus. A lot of people got affected. A lot of people died. And the governments there, instead of criticizing itself for hesitation and making the wrong decisions, they shift the blame to other countries. China happens to be the target. And also there are people within these countries who take an ideological perspective of China. Mm-hmm. They are worried that China, which has a political system of a different kind, will have a sort of a moral advantage or political advantage in the world. So there are all kinds of reasons for the suspicion and criticisms of China. Of course, China has its own share of the problems. During the initial phase of the crisis, China, you know, like other countries, was confused about the new virus. We did not know much about the virus, and we had hesitated. We were confused. We delayed some time. As soon as Chinese government realized that it's a serious problem, took drastic actions very quickly, and very effectively contained the virus. This is one of the focal points for people to criticize China with. I should say it's not fair. It's a real problem, but it's not fair to exaggerate the problem.
As we have seen, some powers in the world have been trying to withdraw itself from the international stage by not contributing much and talking about their country first. And therefore, what does that mean for a country like China, which is a rising power? You know, if you take too many actions, being proactive, others would accuse you of trying to rise and overshadow the incumbent power. However, if you don't, certainly that's not the way to go, because every country has responsibility to support the international mechanism and also to make its own economy, its own society better. So, Professor Jia, once again, how much should China care about, you know, all of these rhetorics?
Well, I think China should care, but should not care that much. it should care because, you know, China is not ready to do a lot of things in a new position of power. Okay. So China has a lot to learn. China makes mistakes. China may not do things as well as it should do. So China should care about those criticisms to use them to reflect and to do better. But at the same time, China should not care too much because many of the criticisms are not correct or are not accurate, are not objective, are biased. I think as China becomes more powerful and more influential on the world stage, China is bound to face more criticisms in the days to come. I think the country which faces more criticism than China does is the U.S. Because it's a superpower. Its interests are everywhere, and it's very big. If it does, whatever it does, it would affect the interests of others. There are bound to be people who are not happy about it. As China rises, China faces the same kind of situation. Whatever China does, this or that, this way or that way, would affect people's interests in other countries. So there are bound to be people who are not happy, who become critical of China. How to face international criticisms in an appropriate way is a big challenge to the Chinese, to the Chinese government.
Yeah, I guess it's a learning curve in a way, Professor Jia, isn't it? Having said that, though, it has a lot to do with the relations between China and the United States. Professor Jia, you've been working on research about that important bilateral relations for decades. So could you help us to understand how do you see that in the so-called the post-COVID-19 period, at least this round of COVID-19?
Well, the situation has been deteriorating over time in recent years, and it's likely to have more problems in the days to come. It's unfortunate that the two countries cannot work together as well as they should during when they face the common enemy, the COVID-19 virus. I think at the moment, probably both countries, especially China, should be patient and should not react to the so-called U.S. provocations that much. Probably should China should just focus on doing its own things well and doing what is right overseas, regardless of the U.S. reactions.
Yeah, we have seen the two parties making China the topic of the election. Apparently, it has become a football in a way that has been kicked around, the issue about China, related to China.
First of all, I think there has been a consensus, political consensus in Washington to be tough on China for all kinds of reasons. You have people of very different kind sharing the same consensus to be tough on China. Okay. And secondly, increasingly, both the Chinese people and the American people think of the other country as the country of another kind, of a different kind. So this is a period of emotions. And if the relationship is not handled, we may end up in a confrontation very quickly. So we have to handle the relationship very carefully now. The administration came down on the opposition party candidate to accuse the opposition candidate, party candidate, to be too soft on China. And of course, the opposition party candidate felt obliged to fight back and say that you are too soft on China. Okay. And they have a new dynamic now. And this dynamic is very harmful to the future management of the relationship. And China is facing a big challenge now, how to stabilize, manage this relationship during this period of time. And it takes a lot of patience and wisdom to handle this relationship to make sure that it doesn't get into a phase of confrontation.
It takes two to tangle. If one is not reasonable, at least in the other's eyes, lack of facts and more of a rhetorics, what can the other party do? What is the ultimate wisdom, if we could fall on China's history, can we rely on, Professor Jia?
So when the U.S., the current administration especially, is not is very proactive, is very uncertain, is not very much responsible and pragmatic, what China can do is not to take on the fights. Well, at the, it will defend its principles. It will defend its sovereign sovereign rights. It will not give in on any of the you know, violations, attacks. But at the same time, it should stay poised and then stay calm and do do what it believes to be right, both at home and overseas, and try to work with people. I mean the rational, the pragmatic people in the U.S. To stabilize the relationship, and wait for a time when the emotions in Washington cool down, and then we can sit down and do things in a pragmatic way. It's important for us not to get emotional, not to get into a conflict because of the emotional reactions.
Very crucial advice. Professor Jia Qingguo, member of the Standing Committee of CPPCC, what a pleasure. Thank you so much, sir.